who are providing the talk in Spanish. I want to welcome our speaker, Keren Rice. Keren is one of those rare, wonderful scholars whose contributions advance linguistic theory while making the culture and practice of linguistics and academic scholarship in general better, stronger, and more humane. Her work and her presence literally make our world a better place. Keren is a professor of linguistics and director for the Center for Aboriginal Initiatives at the University of Toronto. Her work with Dene languages, especially but not only Slavey, is unparalleled. She is past president of the Canadian Linguistic Association and the Linguistic Society of America. She's a member of the American Association for the Advancement of Science and the American Philosophical Society. She is an officer in the Order of Canada and has received the Pierre Chavot Medal of the Royal Society of Canada, an award recognizing her ongoing contributions as a scholar in language documentation and theoretical linguistics and her language activism and work on community-based research. I think it's particularly wonderful that Keren is here for the joint plenary address this year for WCCFL and SAIL, because she's really a driving force in the advancement of a linguistics that is not extractive or objectifying, but that joins with, celebrates, and supports communities of speakers making common cause as partners in advancing both science and human rights. And on a personal level, Keren is a hero. So I'm so delighted to be able to introduce her and turn the stage over to Professor Keren Rice for her talk this morning. Thank you so much for being here.
Okay, thank you for that introduction. It's It's a little bit much to deal with. Okay, so the reason I called this talk Can Formal Linguistics Help Language Reclamation is because of the theme of reclamation here. So what I want to do first is a land acknowledgement to where I am, and then I'll turn to the talk. Amy, thank you for that introduction. It's going to be hard to live up to it. Okay, I'm talking to you from Toronto, and this has for thousands of years been the traditional land of the Huron-Wendat, the Seneca, and most recently the Mississaugas of the Credit River. And today it's the meeting place and home to many Indigenous people from across Turtle Island. So, okay, what I want to do first is introduce myself. Amy already did some of that, and so I'll just repeat some of the things that she said, and then I'll go on to introduce the communities in which I've worked. And I think that this is important to do because I think that we need to understand where we're coming from. So the word positionality is being used a lot today, and I think that's an important thing to understand. So I think I just said this. So I want to also make the point that I can't give you answers because there aren't answers for how to reclaim a language. So understand that this kind of background is important and that there's not going to be answers in this talk. Okay. As Amy said, I was trained as a linguist in a generative framework. I teach at the University of Toronto. And I just want to say I'm also a mother and a grandmother, and my grandson is the big thing in my life right now. I wanted to just tell you the kind of work that I've done with communities, because I think that's important to understand. So I've done a lot of work with speakers and learners of Dene languages since the early 1970s. I've taught workshops and courses in the communities on topics including literacy, grammar, language awareness, language documentation, and language research. I've helped to design dictionaries. And so these are both topical dictionaries and just general dictionaries. And I wrote a grammar of the language. And I didn't put it here, but the first grammar that I did was probably none of you have seen, but it was designed for teaching the language. So I've done both kinds of grammars. I've also been involved in standardization of the writing system and understanding what the goals of standardization are. And the thing that I'll focus on today is the involvement with various projects using language to look at broader issues. And the one that I'll look at is one about stories that tell us about traditional core values and thinking about what self-government means. And I've also been involved in one on caribou and the diminishing caribou herds. So that's the non-academic part. Well, the part of the academics that some people consider to be non-academics. I was the first director of what's now called Indigenous Studies. And I just wanted to tell you a little bit about the kinds of things that we did in that program. And I should say it's just really flourishing at the moment with a lot of hires, and it's very exciting. So what we tried to do was offer a holistic program from an Indigenous perspective or perspectives, and it included languages right from the start. We hired faculty who, the dean, when we hired the first person, said he had never hired somebody without a high school degree. So what we were looking for was excellence at what they did and not the degrees, because there weren't people with PhDs that could take those jobs. And we also worked hard to give these people reasonable teaching loads, because we recognized that they had a lot of continuing obligations in their communities, and that it was to give them a normal teaching load would not be fair to them or to their communities. That we took this as part of the moral and ethical responsibility that the university had to the communities. What I found in the early years is that the students often struggled with the way of teaching, but a lot of them came back a few years later and talked about how much they had actually learned in those courses beyond what they had realized. I've written a lot on ethics of fieldwork and on phonological theory, particularly markedness and variation. And you'll see that one of the things that I'm really interested in is variation, and on the morphology of the Dene verb word. So Dene is the word that's used today for what used to be called Athabascan. Okay, I just want to say geographically. So can you see my cursor? Okay, this is Great Bear Lake here. This is a map of where the Dene languages are spoken. I just wanted to give you an idea of where we are. And this is the particular part of the Northwest Territories that's called the Satu. This community, Fort Good Hope, is 10 miles south of the Arctic Circle, so it's pretty far north. And you get beautiful skies a lot of the year. And these communities are, these three communities, Fort Good Hope, Tulita, and Delany, are where I've spent a lot of time. And the languages are pretty similar in those communities, but they're each distinct at the same time. Okay, these communities are quite remote. So you can get there by boat in the summer, although it takes a long time. You can get there by year round. The communities were not really settled until the 1960s. And I think that that's kind of important, that they weren't really settled. People there were communities there, but people lived most of the year in the bush and with traditional hunting and trapping. And there have been forts prior there in these places with for a number of years. There have been language classes in the schools for many years, but language transmission has decreased over the years, particularly over the last 30 years. One thing I really want to stress is that there's a lot of traditional life in these communities. So there's still a lot of harvesting of food from the land, and the caribou, I said I was involved in a caribou project, and that's one thing that the caribou project is quite concerned about is the diminishing caribou herds. There's a lot of interest on the part of community leaders in developing effective language programs, but they haven't really been very successful. There's a lot of interest in the communities and self-government, and some of the communities now have self-government, and this is one of the projects that I've been involved with. The Dene Nation is an active political group that brings all the communities in the Northwest Territories together, and it has a big interest in languages. And the territorial government produces these regular reports on language status that kind of talk about what they should do, but then nothing very much happens between one report and the next one. Okay. I think that's the end of this section. Okay, so what I'm gonna do in this talk is first look at what reclamation is, because reclamation is a little bit different than revitalization. And I think probably everybody is pretty familiar with revitalization, but reclamation is actually sort of different. Then I'm going to try to define formal linguistics, and then I'm going to look at what learners want to know. So I'm doing this because I want us to be on the same page about what reclamation is and what it isn't, and what formal linguistics is. So I think that this is kind of important to consider. Okay, what is language reclamation? I just put in two pictures here that the one up here is an older picture, and it's what's called a hand game. It's a kind of a stick gambling game. And the one down here is a drummer. I was trying to get one of a drum dance, but I couldn't get a still picture of a drum dance. So, but I just want to say that these things are things that go on often in these communities. So there's really not been a loss of culture the way there has been in a lot of other communities. Okay, so the theme is going to be that reclamation is a type of decolonization. And so I'll just go on. I have too many slides, so this is why I'm just gonna go through them quickly. So I've taken all of this about reclamation from work by Wesley Leonard, who's the person who's really trying to look at what reclamation means and how it comes about. So we'll begin with this definition: a larger effort by a community to claim its right to speak a language and to, I can't see over on the side, so let me just move something, and to set associated goals in response to community needs and perspectives. Reclamation begins with community histories and contemporary needs and is determined by community agents. And it uses this background to develop language work. I think these next points are very important. So reclamation recognizes that in certain worldviews, what in Western science might be considered social factors that are merely associated with language might be part of what someone understands language to be. So he's saying that you can't think about language as an object the way that linguists often do, But you've got to consider it in its larger social setting, and all of that matters. So he says it calls for an ecological approach to language work, one that, sorry, I've got to just keep moving the oh, I know what I'll do. Okay, it's one that recognizes how language is never independent from the environment in which its speakers and potential future speakers live. Language work must be produced in a way that integrates non-linguistic factors. So I think that this is really what distinguishes language reclamation from language revitalization. So revitalization is usually thought of as teaching in a kind of a narrow sense, and reclamation is thought of as a kind of holistic thing. So that's the definition, the distinction that he's trying to make. So what I'm going to be talking about is that larger sense of language rather than the narrow sense of language that linguists often use. Okay, so it goes, and he further defines reclamation as below: the right to use and describe languages, cultural, political, economic, and policy issues, historical and contemporary, that sever communities' relations to their original languages, and broad efforts by a community to claim its right to speak a language and to set associated goals in response to community needs and perspectives. Okay. I want to give you a little bit of what speakers have to say, and there's just a couple slides here. So this one is written in what's called Dene now. It's, so it says, in order to live, our Dene language is essential. And this one is from someone who teaches at the University of Toronto. His name is Ryan DeCare, and he's not a speaker of a Dene language, but of a Haudenosaunee language, that's Iroquoian. And what he said is the part that I bolded: language is not just a means of communication. It holds within it an entire worldview that connects us to our land base, our ancestors, and our communities today and in the future. Language is at the heart of social cohesion within our communities and helps to perpetuate and maintain our collective ethos of life of affirmation. I just want to say a little bit about Indigenous research paradigms. So there's a lot of literature on this now, and it's really interesting literature and quite different approach to looking at language and the situation of language. So let's go on. Okay. So this is, I thought there was one before this. Okay, I guess I'm just confused. Okay, so this is from two Indigenous people in Canada, and basically what they're saying is that research with Indigenous people has to be done by Indigenous people in the lead. So they're not saying it's only that, but they're saying that that's what has to be, those are the people that have to be in the lead. And I won't read through them all. You can read them later if you want to watch the video, or if you want the slides, you can ask me for them. Okay. One of the things that we find in the Indigenous literature is the use of these words. And I've just given a few of these R words. There are lots more of them. But most of these words were, to my knowledge, first used in an article by two Indigenous teachers. And so these are kind of important words, and I'll just read through them: respect, relationships, relevance, reciprocity, responsibility, reflection. I don't think these are the words that we find when we look at the linguistics literature. I think these are the words that we find when we look at the indigenous literature. Okay, I'm just going to give you an idea now of a sample research project that I've been involved with. And this project, it was done with the community, well, with those North Slavey, what are traditionally called North Slavey Sawtu communities. And it was a kind of a research project that was done for a social science and humanities research council grant. And what we looked at was what is called Dene Kede, which means Dene language. And then moving from that to Dene ways of being. And so you can see that there's a kind of a growth here from thinking about language in a sort of a narrow sense to thinking about language more broadly. So let's start off with Dene Kede. I know this is quite small and it doesn't really matter too much. What's important here is that as early as 1993, there were still lots of speakers of the language, a group of Dene people got together and developed curriculum that was integrated learning. And it was sort of a social studies curriculum looking at various philosophical things within the Dene communities. And then it had a lot of language in it, but the language was kind of secondary to the other curriculum. And so that sort of set the stage for something that followed. And so what's happened now in recent years is that people have adopted a term Dene Tsing Li. And that means what it means to be a Dene person. And so what we've been doing is recording stories. And the reason for the stories is to try to understand from those stories about what core Dene philosophy, worldview, and epistemology are. So this is a kind of unusual project in a lot of ways because it takes language, but it situates language from something else. So these are some pictures of Delany, and this particular project was being done there. So we did in 2007, we did a survey with 20 grade 10 to 12 students. At that time, 65% of them spoke Dene and 35 of them spoke only English. I think that they probably had some understanding of it because a lot of the grandparents' generation didn't really speak English, but the younger ones did. And the numbers are probably less than that today. We're going to be doing a survey soon. Okay, so this project was called Stories and Songs as Policy, and what you could see from this list is that it brings together a lot of things. And so it brings together stories and songs, stories and self-governance, stories and health, stories and climate change, and so on. You can read the rest of them. These are the things that were considered to be really important by the people in the communities. And that's why these were the things that were taken on. That's a raven, for those of you who haven't seen them. This is an intergenerational project. It's community-led. There's training. And I should stress that it's two-way training. So the non-Indigenous people are getting trained more than the Indigenous people are, I would say. And there have been a lot of challenges because the capacity on both sides is weak. At times it's strong, at other times There's health issues on the part of people, including me, at one point. History, it's can be hard to overcome the history of colonization, even when you're working closely together. People are busy, leadership changes. So there's a lot of challenges in these projects. As any of you who have worked on any kind of language project will know. I just want to stress that language documentation wasn't the goal when we started this. Language reclamation wasn't the goal when we started it. These were instead emerged from community goals. So I think that for this project, that was really important. That might not be the case for every project. It might start with something else, but it might end up in the same place. And from a camp. So this is camps on the land, and it's about learning and relearning for many people, Dene ways of being on the land camps with language as a strong component of it. So again, it's not about language, it's about Dene cultural heritage. I wanted to talk a little bit about so I'm going to change gears now. So I hope what you got from that is that there are projects that exist that are really focused on reclamation generally. So not just language, but language is a critical part of it. What I wanted to do now is show you some of the theses that were done at the university, that have been done at the University of Victoria. In Victoria, British Columbia, Masters in Indigenous Language Revitalization Program, because I think that this is a program that the next slide tells you something about it. So it's the only one of its kind in Canada, and it's to develop skills for successful project in community and leadership in recovery, revitalization, and maintenance of Indigenous languages. But what you're going to see is that this isn't about language structure, it's about language and life. And so I think that that's really what's important about it, is that it's way, way more than language structure. So I've just given you the names and brief descriptions of the theses, and I'm not going to read through all of these. What I want to stress about all of them is that they're not looking at language structure. This is the closest that there is to language structure, but what it's really about is, what they're really about is groups of people working together to accomplish a goal. And that goal has to do more with worldview, philosophy, and so on, but language plays a critical role there. So there's a bunch of these, and I, especially for the translators, don't worry about translating these. I think that the main point is that they're working to create something that moves them to the future by building from the past. Even this one, which is how I learned the language, the pedagogical structure of the Tahltan language, even this one is really about culture. So. Okay. So I'll just run through these. I might say something about some of them. This one is about puberty camps. So there were ceremonies, especially for girls when they turned when they started menstruating. And this project was about puberty rights. And so you could see that these were really important in the culture, and they want to continue them because it's something about learning how to be a woman. So I think that this is an important thing. Okay. Atsula are love songs, and this one is an interesting one about love songs. So somebody had done some research, an ethnomusicologist had done actually a lot of research in the in one of these communities in the 1970s and 80s, and that became the basis for this research. This is just another one, and it sets out to shed light on it. This is Chilcotin concept of energy that manifests individuals at the beginning, at the onset of a life transition. So there's just some spaces missing here. Okay, I think I skipped one. Oh, this one is the one I skipped. This is a really interesting one about spirituality. Phoebe Taddy is, maybe some of you might have met her actually. She's the person who is in charge of that Dedicated curriculum. And this is what she wrote about. And it's about language, it's suffused with language, but it's about spirituality and the value of spirituality. So I just wanted to introduce those to you to say that this program has the word language revitalization in its name. But what you can see is that it's about so much more than language. And I think that that's really the kind of reclamation part of it in the definition that Wes Leonard gives of reclamation. So what is at the core of reclamation then, as defined by Wes Leonard, is those words with R's that start with R's. And I'll just repeat them here because I think they're important. Respect, relationships, reciprocity, relevance, reflection. Reclamation seeks to understand language in its larger context. It's not about training people to speak the language. It's about accepting definitions that people have of what language is. And so it's a really different kind of concept of language than a lot of us have and that we're trained to in linguistics. So we're trained in linguistics to look for the conservative speakers. We're trained to look for the most conservative forms, and that's sort of what the ideal should be. But this isn't on the slides, I'm just going to say it. That's a kind of a negative thing in a way, because it can be really demoralizing as people can't learn the languages. And so why not accept what they're doing? And that's what he's saying here. Okay. What does linguists see as their responsibility in studying? I don't like the word endangered either, so that's why I put it in those quotes, in studying endangered languages. I've got a lot of quotes here, and basically what the linguists see is the value of diversity. And so this one is from Juliet Blevins. And I should say about all of these people that they're really good linguists, and they've done a lot of work with communities. And so I'm not really being negative to them as linguists. I'm being negative that the goal for speakers is diversity. So this is a great goal for linguists, but it's not a goal for speakers. This is from a recent article by Juliet Blevins and some other people. And again, this is in language, this last year. And what they say is that independent of its scientific merit, we hope that the study of one indigenous language of the Great Plains will inspire other researchers to bring important data from indigenous languages to bear on central issues of linguistic theory and encourage colleagues around the world to continue their high quality language documentation. So again, I don't think that talks at all to speakers. Here's another one. So this one talks about how many languages there are and how important it is to do phonetic research in order to understand the diversity that there is. And this one is from Marianne Methune, and this is from an article where she's talking about language diversity. And so she says, language represents the most creative, pervasive aspect of culture, the most intimate side of the mind. The loss of language diversity means that we will never have the opportunity to appreciate the full creative capacities of the human mind. So I think that this one is also talking to diversity. Marianne has done lots of work with communities, and so that this isn't the only side of her. And the same with the next one. This one is from Ken Hale. And I know you've got a Ken Hale scholarship, and so I'm not meaning to be negative to Ken Hale in any way whatsoever, but he too looks at it from that linguistic perspective and says it's a loss of linguistic diversity is a loss to scholarship and science. This one is from Emin Bach, and he was asked by a speaker why that speaker should work with linguists. Awesome. And this is what he said. We think that children here are not growing up with a knowledge of your language. We can help with your help figure out how to write the words down accurately in your language and learn how the language works. We'll be able to record stories and make dictionaries. Perhaps your children or your grandchildren or their children will one day be glad that we have done this work. Mr. Shaw accepted the answer and right away went to work as an active collaborator, giving us many insights into his language. So linguistic diversity is the concern of linguists, perhaps, but in my experience, speakers of all stripes, and by that I mean fluent speakers, people learning the language, they don't care much about linguistic diversity. They care about family values, identity, community, and things like that. Okay, this is the one I had more trouble with. So I took a definition from Emin Bach, and that's a picture of Emin Bach there. When he was a very young faculty member to Northern British Columbia and to work in a Haisla community. And he just showed up there and he explained to the elder who I talked about earlier, Mike Shaw of that community, what linguists were interested in. And so he said, linguists are interested in the first place in learning about language with a capital L, universal grammar, the unique human capacity that we're born with. In carrying out this theoretical empirical study, it is important to investigate as wide a range of languages as possible. Haisla is, we were sure, very different from English. Ergo, here we are. Well, that wasn't very well received by Mike Shaw, who said, okay, I understand that, but why should we help you? And Emin Bach says, that question has stayed in my mind ever since. And the answer that he gave was the answer that I gave before was the answer that he gave. This is a really interesting article. Let me just remind you about these communities. I read a grant application recently that used the word birth speakers, and I thought it was kind of nice because it said that it wasn't using the word fluent, which is the word that we tend to use. And so I thought saying birth speakers was a little bit different than saying fluent speakers. So that's why I used it. So one of the things about the birth speakers is that they recognize that the languages have changed a lot. And they talk about how their grandparents spoke a language that appears to them to be more complex. I think with Navajo, they call it Old Navajo. And so I think that people are really aware of these kinds of changes in their language. So it's not that they don't expect languages to change. So I think that what they're concerned about from the stories they tell is more about the lessons that you learn from the stories than about the language itself. And I'll give you an example of that later on, if we have time. Okay. So what I see of people is that they are really interested in a few things. So they're interested in sounding right, but that doesn't mean actually sounding the same as the older speakers. It means that there are certain things that they want to be able to do. And I think that is because they get teased for saying things the wrong way. And so they want to get certain things right. They want to sound right as far as intonation, and they want to have intonation that doesn't sound like English. They want to be able to participate in conversations, and they want to get inside the meaning of words. So those are my observations, and this is what these are things people have told me. So. They recognize that they're not going to become fluent speakers the way that their parents and grandparents are. So that's a recognition that they have. Getting inside the meaning of words, in my experience, that's something that the older people that I'm asked by the speakers, the learners don't really ask that so much, and they sometimes get quite disturbed about taking words apart. But as they learn more, and this was really the case with Ryan DeCare, who I showed you earlier, then they get excited about learning the internal structure to some degree. So I think that we've got to keep those things in mind as linguists, that people don't necessarily want to do the kinds of things that we find as linguists to be important, but want to learn other things about from the languages. Okay, so I'm just going to talk a little bit about orthographies, because that's something that linguists often get engaged with. And I'm going backwards. Okay, I did that one. Okay, so I think that what happens when we design orthographies is that we think that there's a right way of doing it, and it's to take a certain linguistic level, and that's usually what was traditionally called the taxonomic phonemic level, and then devise the orthography around that. And what I want to do is just look at a couple of the things that became problematic with that assumption. And I'm doing this because I'm trying to build on how formal linguistics can be useful. And so I want to say that it is useful to some degree, but maybe not as much as you think it might be. Okay, so this is a quote that it comes from Paul Garvin. And so he assumed that he could just go into this community and be able to just deal with the writing system. And I think a lot of people think that, oh, I'll figure out the phonology, I'll figure out what are allophones, and I won't write those, and I'll figure out what are phonemes, and I'll write those. And this turns out that there's lots of challenges. So I'm going to look at two issues, and I'm kind of critiquing the work that we did that was based on understanding a lot of the morphology, and that was based on surface phonemic transcriptions. Okay. So what had been written before we did the standardization was a vowel inventory that was the same in stems and prefixes underlyingly. But as we were doing the standardization, we came to realize that what had been written as a single vowel in stems was actually two distinct vowels. And we also realized that those two vowels were in the prefixes as well. I'll give you some examples on the next slide, but the quality there is predictable. So what we decided was to write the vowels distinctly in the stems, but the same in the prefixes. So this is just a few examples. This is just a little bit of an aside, but because they had been writing the vowels the same, and the vowel that linguists write with an epsilon is more common, what we decided was that one should be written with the letter E, or the English letter E, and that the other one, we talked about how to write it, and people said, oh, you know that funny symbol that linguists have, the schwa, it's an upside down E, so let's use that. A few years later, somebody went into that community and said, oh, that's not the right symbol to use. So I think that it's just a lesson in that, you know, you need to be flexible about things, and there's not something that's carved in stone about these symbols. Okay, so what you see then is that we've got these minimal pairs for the vowels in the stems, but in the prefixes, basically you get the allophones. So you've got an e before the some of the vowels and an a before some of the vowels. So that seemed like a good solution, but actually it didn't turn out to be a very good solution because people were hearing those prefix vowels as A's and wanted to write them as A's. And so I kind of persisted in writing them as for a while, but I've given up on it. And the other thing that this isn't on a slide, but the other thing that I've given up on is when to write nasalization and when not to write nasalization. Okay. So people are hearing the things phonetically. So we had done a lot of work on morphology, but it's clearly not at people's level of consciousness. So, you know, clearly they know it, the speakers know it, but they don't know it consciously. And so this more surfacey transcription turned out to be the right one. So what we were doing here was challenging the Western notion of spelling being a unique way of being a way of judging people. And so we did the same thing with the dictionaries. So there's a lot of variation, and I haven't given you any examples of the variation here, but there is a lot of variation, and it's in sounds and in vocabulary. It was easy to deal with the sounds, with the vocabulary, because you just list the words. But what was hard to deal with was words where there were multiple pronunciations of the same word. And so because we're kind of trained to do the most conservative one and to just give one form of it in a dictionary, but what we ended up doing was giving the variable forms. So people keep bringing up the issue of what about writing stories and stuff, but maybe you can just do the same thing there. And I have the feeling that some of the variation carries meaning with it as well. And so I think that if you're trying to standardize, then you're giving up things. So you could see there's these lessons in challenging things. Okay, I just want to talk a little bit about meaning. So I used to knit a lot, and people would often comment to me that I was wasting my yarn. And I'd sometimes get kind of upset because I didn't think I was wasting my yarn. I thought I was using my yarn, but I didn't think I was wasting it. And so it turns out that this is actually a good reflection of the Dene way of using not just this verb, but verbs in general. And so what do you find when you're trying to get to do elicitation? Is there a lot of verbs where it's hard to know which stem to choose because there's two stems? And I've given you some clear examples here, but you could have examples like two verbs that mean drink and two verbs that mean eat and two verbs that mean carry something. And so that you've got to be really careful to try to figure out what the difference between them is. And these ones I gave you, the differences are clear, and I made them clear so that you could see. I chose these ones so that you could see what the differences are. So if you say the first one, that word gokwi means axe, and sahanion means give me something, but it's giving it to me to keep. If you just said, she or he gave me the axe, if you just asked for that, you could get either one of these and you wouldn't have any idea which one, what the meaning was. Okay, the same, she adopted him, so that's taking somebody permanently with one stem. And then the next one is she took him or her temporarily, like babysat for a couple weeks or something like that. I like the next one. So one means I left my tent behind, and the other one means I lost the tent. And so the result is the same. In both cases, you don't have the tent anymore, but in one case, it's a deliberate action, leaving it behind. And in one case, it's an accident that you lost it. You don't deliberately lose something. And then the same with the next one. She gave the blankets away. That's kind of a nice way of doing it. And the kind of maybe, I hesitate to say not so nice, but that's what I'll say. She gave the blankets away, he threw the blankets away or got rid of the blankets. And that's a different stem. Well, it turns out that this is actually a reflection of what Dene values are, or the Dene Tsingli. And so that there's a concept that people talk about a lot that's called sodinta. And what that means is that there are kind of characteristics that are really devalued and that are really valued in people. So these are industriousness, capability, generosity, mutual supportiveness, cooperativeness, politeness, humbleness, reasonableness. I don't know how to say reserved as an adjective, as a noun. Personally autonomous, caring, restrained, and controlled. What we find is that if it's the sodinta form, then you use one stem. If it's the non-sodinta form, you use the other stem. The thing that's important here is that the non-sodinta form is not negative. It's a kind of an everyday thing. And so it's not censured at all. And it's because people expect that people can't always be sodinta. And so I think that that's a kind of important thing to keep in mind. And what I realized is that people are speaking Dene even though they're speaking English. So because those values are there. So I think that that's an important thing to keep in mind. These are just two slides from Olga Lovick and Siri Tuttle's notion of language teaching. And I thought I would just use these to wind up this section. So that what they say is that it's really helpful to do linguistic analysis. So they what they did was they did a study of prohibitives. And what they found was, this is this one that I like. They did one of comparisons too, but that one is not so persuasive to me. So they began, what they did was they looked at texts and they found texts where there was a lot of conversation. And what they found is that there were lots of imperatives, but there weren't very many prohibitives. And so they asked themselves why. And what they found is that it was a reflection of how one is supposed to behave. And so what they say is that this was an important thing that he described. So again, it's saying you can't objectify the language. You can't just say, here's what the language is, and then expect to use it. What you want to know is how the language is used. Okay. I just want to make sure to say to remember the R words. So those are the relations and so on. I'm out of time, so I want to just do these other two parts quickly. I have some P words that I came up with as director of Indigenous, when I was director of Indigenous Studies, and I found that these words are really important for everything that I do. So these are patience, persistence, perseverance, and passion. And I want to say that there are no wrong, so I want to quote Joshua Fishman here. So this is my part of it. There may be wrong answers, but there aren't right answers for everybody. So to quote Joshua Fishman, what works, what does not, sounds like a simple question, but it is really a most difficult question. As in most complex societal answers, it all depends. And so it's really great to talk with people and to get advice from people, but following that advice, it might not be the right thing for where you are. So you've got to really look at these things as local situations. Okay. Can formal linguistics help language reclamation? I almost forgot this slide. It depends. Okay. What can linguists do? I opened with Wesley Leonard and I'll close with Wesley Leonard. What linguists can do is center details, systems, crafting language documentation in reference to how the language exists in its full context and how communities want it to exist in the future, focusing on relationships and reciprocity, respecting the responsibility that comes with knowledge and its dissemination, and actively engaging with community needs and institutions. So it means paying attention to the people that you work with and seeing what they want. And that's not always an easy thing to do. So you've got to be willing to challenge things that you believe. And I just want to say this last one, presenting the language as an object whose value lies in what it reveals for linguistic theory. Can reduce the people to their value for science. And so one of the joys of doing field work and is getting to know people and it to be thinking that maybe what you're doing, I had an instructor once who said that the people that he worked with were kind of like the things in a chemistry experiment. And so you just worked to see how their language was put together and you had to respect them, but you didn't have to care about them. But I just think that that's not the right way to do it. Okay, I just wanted to show you this poem, and I won't read through the whole thing. I bolded the lines there that were there were the things that happened at the residential schools. And so I think that those are the things. So the author puts, they learn not many things. They learn not to speak their language, but they also learned not to listen to their ancestors, not to respect their culture, not to listen to their grandparents, not to pray their spirit, not to listen to their own self. And so I just wanted to say that there was a lot of loss through the residential schools. And part of our responsibility is to figure out as linguists, and I know not all of you are linguists, but I'm just big, but because I was invited to do this at Wickful and Sale, I wanted to talk to both audiences. I hope that you have gotten something out of this, and I just want to say thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Keren. My next job is to facilitate question and answer. And I think we mentioned before that we're taking questions via email. So we have a couple of questions in the queue, and I will be reading the questions for you. So questioners, I will do my best to do your question justice. Please feel free to message me in the chat if you're a member of the Zoom call or some other way if I get you wrong. And but I will do the best I can. And the first question comes from Mariana Calderon from the National Autonomous University of Mexico. She asks, how do you think the theoretical framework in which you analyze and describe the language is useful for your work in language reclamation may be compared to other theoretical frameworks? Or do you think these are more like independent subfields of the academic work?
I think that they have to come together somehow. And so I think that we've been focusing so much on, and I'm including myself in this, on the academic side. I think we learned something from the academic side, but I think we've got to be really careful that we're not so focused on the academic side that we lose sight of what the people who are interested in learning the language want to know. And so I don't know how to put those together. My birthday is in June and I'm Gemini, and I sometimes feel like I wear these two different hats, and there's the kind of formal linguist side of me and there's the community side of me. So I don't really know the answer to that question. I wish there was a way that we could figure it out, but I don't know what the answer is.
Thank you. The second question.
Let me just add, I think if you look at people like Melvitha Chi, she's really trying to develop a Navajo or Dene theory of verb structure. And so I think that there are people that are really deep into the culture, like way more than I am, and they're the ones that are going to be able to do that work.
Thank you. Our next question is from Keith Fay with the Ronan Institute. And Keith writes, dear Professor Keren Rice, many thanks for your fascinating presentation. Your work touches on the many points of overlap between languages, linguistics, and culture, not to mention the humanities such as history, politics, sociology, etc. It is of course right to take a broad approach towards language and consider the many facets in which language interfaces with other academic disciplines, but where should we draw the line between linguistics as the study of language, and other academic disciplines, lest we lose sight of the fundamental properties of our discipline, namely linguistics. Please advise, and many congratulations on the birth of your grandchild.
I think that's a hard question. I think that in academics, well, let me answer it from the perspective of Indigenous research. So what the word that you find a lot in Indigenous research is that you can't study these things independent of one another. And so what you really need, I think, are teams of people that get together and work with each other in order to do this. I was really fortunate when I first started working with helping to develop curriculum materials that I was working with speakers and I was working with educators. And so I could bring the linguistics and they could bring the other pieces of it. And so I think that I think to do this kind of work in its fullness, that's what you need. You need to have a team of people where there's the depth of knowledge in each of the areas, but you can communicate with each other.
Thank you. Our third question is from Khan Kilic from Istanbul Aydin University. And Khan writes, do you think the approach of some linguists could be interpreted as white savior complex? Do you think training willing Indigenous people in linguistics might be a better approach in general rather than sending linguists into Indigenous communities?
I think that at this point, we haven't figured out as linguists what it is, how to do a good job teaching this. So I think that linguists need to do a lot of stepping back and thinking if we really want to have these programs, then we need to figure out what's the way of doing it that's going to make sense. And I'll just put in a little plug for my department. We've just hired three people. One of Ryan DeCare, who I talked about earlier, is 50% in linguistics and 50% in Indigenous studies. He's doing a PhD now at the University of Hawaii at Hilo. And so he's learning a lot about this. And I think that we've hired somebody who's coming from the UVic program, who's also Mohawk. And I think he's gonna be able to contribute a lot. He'll be starting in September. And then we've also hired Pedro Mateo, Pedro, who some of you might know, and he's teaching language revitalization now. So I think we're fortunate to be able to have gotten these people, and I think it's going to change the way that we're teaching linguistics in the department. We've also got a student coming as a master's student who's got some background in linguistics, and I think she'll be insightful too. So I think what you need to do is look at places like UVic, the University of Victoria, to see what kinds of things they're doing, and they'll be really helpful to us in figuring out how we need to change.
Thank you. I'm going to do a chair's prerogative and ask a question of my own, if that's all right. I don't think I introduced myself before. I'm a career track associate professor here at the University of Arizona in the Department of Linguistics, where of course I'm very interested in building out the kind of university side infrastructure that you've been successful with at Toronto. And I'm wondering if you could share a little bit more about what caused you to start lobbying for the programs that you've been so successful in developing.
I'd say that there are two things, and it was the government at first that said that there had to be programs in there, that universities had a responsibility to Indigenous people. The word Aboriginal was used at the time. And so I think that there was a committee set up, and I was asked to be on that committee. And then the committee set up a program that was between linguistics and anthropology. But I would wake up in tears at night because it would be August, and I didn't know yet if I would have the funding to be able to offer the courses at night, that September. And so I went to the dean and said that this wasn't the right home for the program. And so we then got an independent home for it. So, but I was really clear from the start that, well, I got a lot of advice from people. I worked very closely with First Nations House. We hired really great people and who took it seriously, even when they were promised one course one year and three courses the next year and two courses the next year. I worked hard to avoid having quantity be the thing that counted. So I didn't really care how many students there were in the class. I felt like it was more important. But it's sort of like your NAMA program, where where what's important is not the number of students, but it's that people have a place to see themselves within the context of the university. And we tried from the start to focus on Indigenous ways of viewing things rather than settler ways of viewing Indigenous people. So that's, you know, I learned just a huge, huge amount through that. So I don't know, I guess those are things, but that was like 25 years ago. So I think that that what's happened in the intervening time is that we sent out, well, we were just an undergraduate program that was called a minor when we started, and then we expanded it to what's called a major. And then the University of Toronto has three levels of degrees, and the third one is called a specialist. And so we were able then to expand it to a specialist program. And it's an undergraduate program. Now there's been a lot of hiring going on in the past few years, and so it's going to be possible to get a graduate program as well. What I found is that I had to be, that's where those P words, that's where I got these P words from. I had to be persistent, but I realized that there was a lot of oral support, but it was hard to get the money to be able to do it. But then the Canadian universities in Canada, there was a Truth and Reconciliation Commission report that was issued a few years ago, and that has really made a difference in terms of hiring. So we've got so many Indigenous scholars now teaching in the widest variety of departments, and they don't have to be teaching Indigenous studies. They should be teaching everything. Like, you're not saying that all Asian faculty should be teaching in Asian studies, and so why should, or all Black faculty should be teaching in Black studies or whatever it's called in your university. So I think I think there have been a lot of things that have been done in recent years to make changes. The president of the university accepted an eagle's feather from the chairs of the committee that were following up on the Truth and Reconciliation Commission. And so that's a big responsibility on his part.
Thank you. I have an anonymous question that says, I would just like to thank you for your words and thoughts today. I truly appreciate the time you took to explain the different aspects of your work. My question is about the approach one takes to gather information and data from an Indigenous community. Has there been any research of how Indigenous people themselves ask each other about Indigenous knowledge or aspects of life, or even what prompts a knowledgeable community member to share or teach what they know? And how could you incorporate such a way of gathering information into your research methods? They close by saying, again, thank you for sharing with us today. Oh, and I'm sorry, this person did not wish to be anonymous, so I'm very happy to tell you this is from Joseph Marx Kodak, and he says, Gunalchesh. Thank you.
Yeah. I think that there's the situation that I've been working in is maybe unique. There's a person who I'm a close friend with who lives in one of these communities. And so I think that that makes a really big difference. That curriculum, the Dene K-Day curriculum, was done entirely by Indigenous scholars, and not PhD type scholars, but the people that were knowledgeable. So I think that it's all about relationships. And if you've got the relationships, it's going to work. If you don't have the relationships, people aren't going to trust you. So you've got to have somebody where there's a trust relationship there for these things to work. People often will agree with you because they think they should. And so you've got to be able to build up those relationships, and that takes time. And so it means going back. And so to do this work right, I think there, like I said, maybe there's no one solution for it, but I think that there are things that have to be done in an appropriate way. And so you've got to just know what those things are. And it takes time.
Thank you. I think we have time for one more question. And I wanted to take you up on your offer from earlier in your talk. You were discussing people's observations about language change. And I think you said you had an example that we could ask you for if there was time. Do you recall that? And do you have that example?
I think what you find is that people talk about high language or something like that. Okay, here's a good example. The younger ones, so this would be people that are probably in their 50s now, they tend to, so these verbs are really complicated, as Amy knows well. And so they tend to mash things together. And the older ones, that things don't get mashed together in the same way. So that the younger ones have a lot harder time doing morphology. And I'm gonna just use some technical terms now, even with the disjunct prefixes, which are pretty clear, the younger ones have a harder time doing that morphology. And so it's harder to figure out what the meanings are then. And the older ones, they don't do that. So the people that I worked with in the 70s and 80s, they didn't do that. Most of them aren't alive now. So I think that you've got to be careful about those kinds of things. And I think in the northern languages that I've worked with, so for instance, if you take Klingchong, there's been so much loss of consonants in conjunct prefixes. So are you doing the morphology right to say that it's the morphology that it was when those consonants were there, or has the morphology changed completely? And so I think those are the kinds of examples that you can look at. And people are very conscious of these kinds of things. They wouldn't be able to say it, but they wouldn't necessarily be able to tell you what the difference was, but they're aware that the younger speakers are speaking differently than the older speakers.
Thank you so much. And I think we are just at the end of our scheduled time. So I want to again thank our interpreters and our tech support team for doing such a beautiful job this morning. And thank you so much, Keren. This was wonderful. I have so many ideas now to share with my students and bring out into my own work. Thank you for being here. And thank you everyone for participating. So great to see you all, whether you were here in the Zoom call or on the live streams. Thank you, thank you, thank you. And I hope you'll continue participating in SAIL and WCCFL in the sessions that come. Thank you.
Thank you.